We are seeing a period of epic drought. The extremes are becoming more extreme. We have to plan for that because it affects all of us.
Today, TechKnow not only gets a satellite's view of California's epic drought from NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab.
We're the eye in the sky.
We also get a boots-on-the-ground perspective in the Central Valley where once fertile fields have gone to dust.
My parents were migrant farm workers. And then we established our family here in the early 50s, and that's where I grew up and learning a lot about farming, especially cantaloupes.
Growing fruits and vegetables has been Joe Del Bosque's life work. But this year, about a third of his fields will sit unplanted and unproductive.
Our water comes from the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation, and they allocated zero water to us this year. So we did not have enough water to plant this field.
This is California's Central Valley, known as the world's food basket. These fertile lands feed the nation. California produces nearly half of America's fruits, nuts, and vegetables. But without water, these fertile fields become a dust bowl. And the impact is widely felt. With nearly 430,000 acres left unplanted and the loss of 17,000 jobs, the drought is costing California $2.2 billion. And for the nation, an increase in food prices for years to come.
And if it's a dry year, it will be a disaster that's never been seen before.
What are you gonna do, Joe?
You know, it's scary to think about it.
Water doesn't always come naturally. Dry spells and droughts are common to this region. Bringing water here is an engineering feat. 20 reservoirs transport water from Northern California to the Central Valley through canals and pumping stations. Today, all of the major reservoirs are way below capacity. Shini Somara went to one of them to see for herself.
The San Luis Reservoir is behind me. When it's 100% full, it's up to that water line just there. But as you can see, during this period of drought, it's only 20% full.
These images show just how depleted some of California's reservoirs are today. And these all-time low water levels can also be seen from space. So I paid a visit to NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab to learn how scientists are using new technology to track water availability.
Our computer models suggest, and the climate community agrees, we will be seeing more of this in the future, and not just in California, but across the whole southwestern United States. So more prolonged drought could become the new normal here.
Jay Familietti is a hydrologist and JPL's lead water scientist.
The space-based perspective is a really unique one in that you really get a holistic view of water storage and how it's been changing over time. One of the things that we've learned is that over the last 3 years, California's lost about 4 trillion gallons of water per year. To put that in perspective, that is more water than all 38 million people in California use each year.
What are you guys seeing with your satellites?
So we're seeing a few key things here in California. We see that the last wet season, last winter, was drier than most of the previous dry seasons.
Our wet seasons are so dry, they're worse than a dry season.
That's right.
That's unbelievable.
Right. It is.
Most of the western United States has been in drought for the last 15 years. But what California is experiencing is exceptional drought, the most intense categorization. JPL's GRACE satellite generates unprecedented data that not only backs what we see on the ground, but shows a dangerous tipping point.
Economically, what's that going to do to California?
Well, it's going to have a big impact on the agricultural industry, of course. We need water to grow food, and that will ripple through the economy of the United States.
NASA's other aerial mission is taking flight above the Sierra Nevada mountains, a vital source of California's water supply. And here too, the news isn't good. Less snow in the winter means less water in the spring and summer. According to the California Department of Water Resources, the snowpack is at its lowest level since 1988.
So tell me, why is snow important?
So snow is really it's a critical resource.
Tom Painter is a snow scientist and director of JPL's Snow Optics Lab.
The main thing we're focused on right now is understanding the snow water equivalent.
How do you measure that?
We developed what's called the Airborne Snow Observatory, which is a combination of the spectrometer to measure how much sunlight is being absorbed by the snowpack, and a scanning LIDAR, which is like a high-frequency laser pointer, and it measures the snow depth. The instruments look out this hole in the belly of the plane. The snowpack is a reservoir of water. It snows up there, it stays up there until the spring, which is about the time that we're using it for agriculture, for municipal use. So there's this nice handoff of water, so water can come out of the reservoir and it can be backfilled by the snowmelt. And that information then is fed to water managers that gives them an idea of the forecast for the coming weeks.
And the forecast isn't good. The lack of significant snowfall is just one issue scientists must deal with. The other is man-made.
Dust and black carbon that's coming from industrialization and accelerates snowmelt in ways that we haven't understood previously.
Here at JPL's Snow Optics Lab, scientists collect snow samples and use a spectrometer to measure for levels of dust and black carbon.
Dust and black carbon are dramatically accelerating snowmelt.
So at the end of a mission that you guys do, you end up with a map like this. What am I looking at?
Right. This map gives us an instantaneous snapshot of how much water there is in the basin and where it's located. Having this kind of information is key to optimizing that reservoir.
At the core of this mission's success is the computer technology developed to build maps and models of the snow water equivalent within 24 hours.
You guys are already changing the way water's managed.
Having the best possible information is critical to maintaining our economy, maintaining the agriculture, maintaining the municipalities.
But NASA scientists aren't just tracking water in our mountains. Their satellite images are also revealing groundwater depletion. When surface water from precipitation is scarce, desperate farmers start drilling for groundwater. Back in the Central Valley, Shini met up with a team from the U.S. Geological Survey who are also keeping an eye on the shrinking aquifers.
Since I've been working in the Central Valley, I have not seen this many wells needing to be drilled or heard of this many wells going dry.
Claudia Font is a hydrologist with the USGS.
And as they pump the groundwater, the water levels drop, and this year with all the drought, they're lower than they've been in a long, long time.
So is it completely unrealistic to think of these deep level aquifers as just an unlimited resource?
We are actually lowering the water levels, you know, lower than their historic lows. We're taking more water out than we're recharging the system.
But there's an even more immediate impact of all this well digging: land subsidence.
Subsidence is the lowering of the land surface.
Michelle Sneed of the USGS tracks how much subsidence is occurring and where.
This is a canal. As subsidence occurs, the road lowers, the water's starting to run into part of the bridge, and it needs to be raised.
And actually the water is flowing this way, isn't it?
Right, the water's flowing this way, and that's why all of these items are sort of shoved up against the bridge instead of flowing underneath the bridge if there was some space between the water surface and the bridge.
It's really unbelievable. You can see that.
But what's perhaps most alarming is that subsidence permanently changes an aquifer's ability to hold water.
So what happens is that aquifer system can hold less water than it did before subsidence, and that's forever. That is permanent.
Coming up on TechKnow, using the sun to turn wastewater into liquid gold.
Okay, I'll take your word for it.
Believe it or not, this is one of the world's most productive agricultural regions, California's Central Valley. And as you can see, it's suffering from a drought of epic proportions.
The state of California is grappling with its third year of drought in a row, and farmers have been the first to feel its devastating effects. Drive through the Central Valley, and their anger and bitterness is visible. Dennis Velasquez is manager of the Pinoche Water District. It's his job to figure out how to supply water to 38,000 acres of farmland.
Never in our wildest dreams did we ever think we'd be looking at a 0% water supply.
And when President Obama visited the area in February, farmer Joe Del Bosque took the opportunity to stress the wider impact of California's agricultural losses.
My pitch to him was that California agriculture is important. It's important to the whole nation. As we passed by a tractor that was parked out here in the field, and I said, Mr. President, do you know where this tractor comes from? And he looks at it and says, John Deere. Yes, we love John Deere in Illinois. And I told him, Mr. President, when we buy a tractor in California, we're creating jobs in Illinois. And during a drought, we don't buy tractors.
With the drought not likely to end soon, there is an urgent need for solutions. NASA's Jay Famiglietti says new water-based satellite missions will help farmers strategize and maximize their crops.
SMAP stands for Soil Moisture Active Passive, and it is a mission that will map the water in Earth's soils, which we call soil moisture, which is just the water in the upper few centimeters of the land. Every few days, we'll get a global update, and that will be extremely important for things like agriculture and a number of other applications, so it has the potential to be revolutionary.
And water districts are looking into local solutions. Here in Firebaugh, Falaski's team is looking to tap into a new resource, underground drainage water. Naturally occurring salts, selenium, and other heavy metals make this water unfit for irrigation or human consumption.
This is what we call subsurface tile water. Historically, this water has been problematic water. Our goal is to take this water and turn it into a productive resource.
Wow, so this water actually runs underground about 8 feet, and you've brought it up to the surface. You're going to clean it up, and then you're going to tap it back into the crops.
That's the plan.
Desalination is the process of removing salts and minerals from brackish water. Conventional desalination technology is often very energy intensive. But here in Firebaugh, they've built a desalination plant that runs on something that the Central Valley has plenty of, solar thermal energy.
That's what's really important about solar power, is we can use the sun to reduce the amount of fuel or electricity. And that's very, very important from an overall energy footprint.
Aaron Mandel is the CEO and founder of WaterFX, the company behind the solar-powered desalination plant. Its most prominent feature is this 377-foot-long parabolic array of mirrors.
So we're using this large mirror here to capture the heat. The sunlight is reflected to the center receiver tube.
Mineral oil travels down a central tube and is heated up by the sun to 248 degrees. The heat is then piped into evaporators and the steam is generated. Fresh water is condensed from the steam, and salt and other minerals are removed in the process.
And what percentage of the water is purified?
We can go to 93% water recovery.
Is 93% a typical amount of recovery?
No, it's not. It's very high, and that's what makes this process different from traditional seawater desalination, which operates only at about 50% recovery.
Wow.
And this recovered water is even safe enough to drink.
So I brought you some water samples.
Okay, I hope it's not that I have to try.
No, this is the salty drainage water, and this is the product water that we're producing, which you can see is very clear, but more importantly, doesn't have any salt in it.
Okay, I'll take your word for it.
How did it taste?
It tastes very earthy.
Even though we haven't added any chemicals that you would normally add for municipal drinking water, it's absolutely safe. And that's the whole point of the process, that we can make clean drinking water just using the sun.
Plans are underway to add 70 more parabolic mirrors over this 50-acre site. When it's completed, Mandel says they'll be able to process 2 million gallons of fresh water per day.
I think one of our biggest challenges is just getting farmers to think that desalination could actually be a reliable source of water.
Water manager Dennis Falaski isn't quite as optimistic.
We need to start looking at water treatment as an additional water supply for the state of California and the world. Water is going to become our future gold.
NASA's Jay Famiglietti believes water-based satellite missions will be critical to managing this precious resource for future generations.
I think we'll see a number of new satellite missions, some of them being launched here at NASA. We'll have a much better three-dimensional picture 10 years from now. That will be great information for water management. So once we understand how much water is available to us as snow and is accessible in streams and reservoirs and in groundwater, which actually gives me great hope thinking about moving forward the next decade.
For farmers like Joe Del Bosque, hope goes hand in hand with water.
Gosh, I can't imagine anything rooting itself in this.
It transforms itself with water. It becomes completely different and has very rich soil. Last year we had cantaloupes growing here, and so we're going to plant cantaloupes again.
You're optimistic about that?
I hope so. All it takes is water.